Okay, so for today, it's just a practice problem or two, and we take a practice test. I just talked about how I have peers who want me to test tomorrow instead of today. And so anyway, imagine for a moment you had asymptotes that went this way, and this way, and this one's at 3, and this one's at 7. Would you know what the equations are for those?
I know, they're x equals something and y equals something, but do you know which one's which? Some of you are like, well, I can guess, and I can get like 50-50 chance. That's not good enough. There's horizontal and there's vertical. This looks like the horizon. It's a horizontal. And which one goes with that? Say it if you know it. Y, the horizontal. So Y equals 3. Raise your hand if you had that one right. Awesome. And the other one, therefore, is X equals 7. Okay, next. Our graphs usually look like this, unless they don't. Why would it not look like that? What if there was a negative in front? What would happen to it? Do you remember? If there was a negative? Tell it. It would flip. So here's what flipping looks like. This goes down to here, and then the other one would go up to there. So it wouldn't be here anymore. It'd be the red ones. Does that make sense to you? Okay, next. That one, you can tell which way it got moved. It got moved to the right, and it got moved up. So can you tell me the equation for it?
If you don't know the answer, then you can say, phew, glad the test wasn't today. This might be one of the tougher ones. Tyler, what do you say? Raise your hand if you agree with him. You are correct. Except this one got reversed. Like I had it in the blue spot, but then I reversed it. So that do you get, technically I'd need a negative there because this is the reversed one. It depends on if you think I meant the original one or the reversed one. The reversed one would need a negative. Okay. Another one. I'd like you to just tell me the three important points. You know, the two perfect points and then the asymptote that runs through them for this. On an XY chart, there's the asymptote and two perfect points. That's all you have to have is the asymptote, two perfect points. All right, if you don't have them at least started by now, then you're probably really stuck. It's whatever makes this 0, which would be -1. That makes the asymptote. And which one? That's x equals that. That's the asymptote. X equals -1. And then what's above it and below it? Well, you go on either side. Think of it as like an number line. And 0 would be on one side of it, and -2 would be on the other side of it. And if I put in a 0 here, figure out what you get. And then if I put in a -2 there, see what you get. Did you get 5 and 3? Raise your hand if you had those right. Okay, excellent. So there's that kind of question. And then there's this kind of question. What do you think will be the key on a problem like this? Some kids are going to forget this key step and they will get it wrong. Noah, can you tell me one thing that has to get done on this problem?
You have to flip the second equation.
Correct.
So I'm going to change this to x squared minus 36 and times flip this over. You are correct. Without that, you can't possibly get it right. But now there's another key step. Sure, finish up.
Expand x squared minus 36 and cancel out the x plus 6.
X plus 6, x minus 6, and then this cancels this. And then you see what's left on top is just a 1. You could say there's a 1 here too. When you cancel stuff, you leave a 1 behind. You get a 1 over. Now there's two states of mind on this. Some people say that that's the best answer, and I agree with those people. There's other people, this is even teachers, who say we should make them multiply it out. I'm not going to make you multiply it out because I've said over and over again, if you can factor it, you should. So I'm going to take this answer, but I also have to take this answer because some kids are being told by their teacher that they have to multiply it out. So I'll take either one, okay? But you get factoring safer because then if there was like an X up here, then you'd be able to see that the X would cancel. But if there was an X here, you wouldn't see that the X could cancel. So factoring is always safer. All right. And I think that's enough. But wait, we gotta do one common denominator problem. That needs a common denominator, and then you'll be able to subtract it. Be really careful with the negative. If I hadn't said be careful with the negative, I bet you seriously 7 kids in here would have had it all right, except they would have screwed this negative up. Now, try not to screw it up since I've called it out so much. That negative is really important. I think you all know by now to multiply everything by 7 over there and 2 over here. The only thing I'm worried about is that negative. I'll pause for a second while you give it a shot. Okay, so it's obviously 7 over 14 here, minus something over 14 there, and that's the tricky part. Now, I know some of you are going to mess this negative up, so I'm going to be really, really careful with it. In fact, I'm going to get rid of the negative, and I'm going to say that's like a 2 with the negative on it. I could move that 2 to the front, couldn't I? And then it would be like a negative 2 times both of those things. So it's going to be negative 4. That's a weird looking 4. Negative 4x plus 6. And then if I put this 7 with this 6, that'll make 13. Negative 4x plus 13 all over 14. Now process that for a minute. I know some of you thought it was negative 6. It's not. Because this negative will distribute to this negative. And you can see how a lot of kids are going to get that wrong. All right. So I feel like you're ready. And today's practice test is on paper, and if you're one of the students that's going to be doing it online, I'll have it posted there online once we're done with today. So if you're absent today, just look for it online. Do a practice test. And that's all I got for you for today.